Hi, everyone. Thanks again for joining another great meeting, great conversation with Dan Rosenzweig. Dan is the CEO and chairman of Chegg, which we talked about several times on this channel. Prior to joining Chegg, he was the former Yahoo COO and also the former ZDNet or ZDNet. Everyone can call it however they want. He was their CEO and now active chairman and CEO of Chegg. Let me add Dan to the stream and we can see him now. Hi, Dan. Good morning.
Shalom. How are you?
Shalom, shalom, like we say. Hi. We are great. And I want to start by thanking you for joining and for giving us the opportunity to expose Chegg to investors, to people that don't know the company, don't know the amazing things and might have heard about the company through the offices you have in Israel, but maybe through other avenues. So thank you very, very much. And,
well,
you know,
pleasure.
Go ahead.
It's my pleasure. And most people always add that I was the CEO of Guitar Hero just because they think it's cool.
Oh, sorry, I didn't find that on your bio. Of course, the CEO of Guitar Hero is even cooler than that. I can tell you that most of my viewers, because I admit to that, I keep saying that I'm a boomer. I'm not trying to convince anyone otherwise. And, you know, we know Guitar Hero. That's how I learned guitar, playing in the air. So
yeah, it's how most people learned 80s music, too. So
exactly. So maybe we should talk about Guitar Hero, not Chegg. No, just kidding. We came here to talk about Chegg. So kind of to start the conversation, why don't you tell us what attracted you to Chegg? What is exciting about Chegg? And even to the ones that are now Chegg, I haven't even heard of that company. What do Chegg kind of, where are you doing your business? What is your unique capabilities? Kind of the spiel of Chegg.
All right, so I'll give you the whole spiel. So I've been with Chegg now. This is actually my 13th year. And what attracted me to Chegg was what I think would attract most boomers, which is we care about education. We have benefited dramatically from education, from access to education. And most of us had the chance to grow up in homes where education was considered the key to the middle class and the key to the future.
Correct.
And I was very much the same. And my mom was a public school teacher for 39 years. And my wife's mother was the secretary to the deans in the high school that we went to. So education was always around my life and always considered important in my life. And so when the opportunity presented itself to run an education company to increase access to people who historically have not gotten the information or have not gotten support or have not or it's too expensive for, or who never got access to tutoring or information about which college to go to, that we saw the opportunity to build a platform that solves some of the biggest pain points that students had from high school to college and now global. And we started with textbook rental because we couldn't control the price of college, which is still today exorbitant. College debt in the United States is extraordinary. It's nearly $1.8 trillion, and 44% of all Americans have some form of student debt. 43% of Americans go to college but never get a degree. And so what we're doing is we're bankrupting hardworking young people who are trying to use education to advance their lives. And it turns out nobody was on the side of the student. Everybody was on the side of taking a toll from the student. So we set out to build a company who focused on student first, a platform using the internet and technology to increase access, lower cost, make it on demand, make it high quality, and give people the academic support they needed whenever they got stuck, no matter what subject, what language, what country. So we started out as a textbook rental company in the United States. That is now a teeny part of our business. We are now exclusively digital with homework help, math support, writing support, any subject, math, science, STEM, anything that you possibly need to help you master the subject and improve your outcome. And we're now in 190 countries. So, I mean, Chegg is now a global company, whereas 13 years ago, we were almost bankrupt. So it just shows that if you bet on the inevitable, which is more people are gonna need more help learning more things, and they're gonna be more on their own, then Chegg is the kind of investment that you would contemplate.
Yeah, and that's an amazing concept to kind of follow, because in Israel, just for my viewers to kind of connect between the dots, in Israel, there is a, let's call it a subsidy through the government that the universities, most of the universities, except the colleges, the private colleges, but most of the universities, which are very high quality, are quote unquote subsidized. So the cost is, if I tell you the cost, then you would laugh out loud and you would say, everyone, go have a degree. Like if I convert it, let's say $4,000 a year tuition.
Yeah. Look,
to the best universities.
To the best in Israel, and which are some exactly. of the best in the world. And so, you know, we understand that. But even students in Israel struggle with mastering the subject. Exactly. Not everybody has had the same support in their homes. Not everybody's had two parents. Not everybody, I mean, you know, it is not everybody was born in Israel. Or, you know, many have immigrated
from
all over the world. And that's how Israel was built. And need the support. So we are agnostic to your background. We are incredibly affordable and incredibly helpful, regardless of what country, what language, what subject that you want to study. And we are very fortunate, as you mentioned, we have an office in Israel that is now 65 people. We've had that office for nearly 12 years. And that office, like many companies that are global, it's a technology-driven office because the technological skills in Israel are second to none. But their leadership in terms of what to build, how to build it, all the different platforms, you know, obviously mobile, the app store, all the feature sets. So we, you know, they are very cognizant of not only is what needed in the United States, but what's needed around the world and what's needed in Israel. And without them, Chegg wouldn't be Chegg. So they'd kill me if I didn't
kudos,
give them a shout.
I want to say kudos to you for let's say the environment in the company that you provided, because this interview, and I'll tell you behind the scenes, would not even be thought of unless one of your employees in Israel, Vitali, which is a That's right. frequent viewer of my channel, and kept writing comments about what do you think about Chegg. And, you know, we're going to talk about that in a second, about what happened kind of from a stock perspective, not in financials as well. And he kept asking me, and I told him, look, right now, you know, there's something going on. I wouldn't put my money yet unless you understand what's going on. And he didn't tell me back then in the comments that he's an employee. Eventually, he told me, and I said, you know what? Let's have this conversation. Most of the people are afraid to send an email to their CEO, but he made it happen. So that's an amazing culture to work, and that's amazing. And I want to say it here. Kudos to you for creating that environment in the company.
Well, look, thank you very much. And Chegg is one of the great companies to work at, not because of me. I'm benefiting from the extraordinary employees that are at Chegg, but I've never found the Israeli office to be shy about asking for things that they want.
To say the least.
So look, I was grateful that they care. And look, they're not trying to get our stock up. They're trying to get people to understand and appreciate and love the mission the way we do. You know, when you get up every day and you can help a young person achieve their goals, improve their outcomes, get a better life, have a chance to reach the middle class, learn something that's important in their minds to learn because they either need to or they want to, that's a great way to live your day. And so I think that's why our employees, you know, especially the ones in Israel, are so passionate about what we do. And we're very fortunate that way. Look, I've run a lot of great companies. You mentioned them earlier. They've all been incredibly fun and with extraordinary people. But this is really an incredible mission-driven company where if you had the chance to help students improve their outcomes through learning something or mastering something, you would want to do it. So I'm grateful to Vitali for pinging me several times.
Yeah, I'm sure. And that's amazing. Let's take us back 2 years ago, COVID. Before we talk about the financials, I want to still stay on the company level, right? COVID made huge changes for companies, organizations, corporates. Yes. Would you say Chegg 2022 looks better or worse due to COVID? Not financially, but from how the company operates?
I don't know that you can say better or worse. You know, this has been a struggle for every employee in every company everywhere, particularly parents that work, particularly parents that have kids in school. That's been a global phenomenon. Our Israeli office is no different, right? They couldn't wait to get back to the office. And as soon as we opened it up, they're like, well, maybe not so fast. and I think that's universal at this point. You know, so I can't say it's better or worse. I can say it's been exhausting. I can say that for most people, to work over a rectangle, to have your life come down to transactional minutes rather than relational minutes, which is what you get to do in person, is exhausting. Some people love it for the freedom, for the lack of commute, because they're more introverted. Some people hate it. And companies are filled with people who feel both ways.
Yeah.
And then there's all the political issues about vaccination or not vaccination. You know, in Israel, you were on your fourth vaccination before 40% of people in the United States were even willing to take a vaccination. You know, it's hard to manage and lead people if you never get to meet them. And, you know, I have daughters that are 28 and 26, and one of them switched two jobs during COVID. And you know, I watch their struggles, because for me as a parent, I was fortunate enough to live with my daughters and their boyfriends and my wife for, you know, for nearly a straight year, which yeah. for a parent is a gift and a pain in the ass, as you know. But, you know, watching them and experiencing them what they experienced, I think was really helpful for me for getting a greater appreciation for what the parents in my company or the children in my company were experiencing, because I couldn't see them. I couldn't talk to them. You had to schedule everything. So I don't know that we're better or worse. I think we are fortunate as a company, and I think we're grateful as employees that we were able to band together and stick together and support each other and care and give and support our students. And honestly, you know, the first part of COVID, I think, was scary for everybody. Nobody knew for sure. how bad it would be or what was going to happen. And people were dying in massive numbers, and the vaccines hadn't been created. And as a parent, as a human, as a citizen of the world, but as a CEO or an employee, those things are petrifying. And I think we all learned to come together in ways that we didn't know we had the capacity to do so. And to that degree, I'm grateful that we know we have that reservoir of hope and love and support. But it's not been easy. And the next chapter is also not going to be easy, because now we're going to get into, well, who wants to come in? Who doesn't want to come in? And what's office like life? But our mission and the kinds of people that our mission attracts brought us together and kept us together. And I'm insanely grateful for that.
And again, that I can't even say how amazing that is. But during COVID, your business, if we now kind of dive into the financial aspect, and the financials can be looked through two different lenses. One is the lack of visibility that you encountered during the COVID, where you found yourself, and I'm going to share the screen here. I have a screenshot where this is something that fascinates me to hear your thoughts. So what I'm sharing right now is not this. Let me share it correctly. Like this is an interview a day after you reported earnings with Sarah Eisen on CNBC, actually on the same day, where you saw basically most of the gains that your company had during COVID being destroyed in the stock market, the stock being dropped 47% after that, you know. And you were very transparent back there and said, look, we didn't have visibility. We can't tell you what's going to happen. We know, we're going to talk about what happened later on, of course. But before we talk financials, and we look through charts. So for us, a stock drops, it might be, if you're invested, a bad day. If you shorted that stock, you're happy. But when I put myself in your shoes, I'm frightened. I want to say, I don't even know how would I feel sitting in front of CNBC, in front of Sarah Eisen or whoever interviews you, when the stock in the background goes 47% down. How did you feel? Before we go dive into the numbers, what, you know, that's something that we don't have the opportunity to ever feel or hear someone talk about that. And if it's okay with you, I'd love to hear, how did you feel those hours, those days where your market cap is cut by half?
Yeah, well, it's nice of you to dance around and ask softball questions like that. so look.
No, actually, it's not softball. I'll get to the difficult questions in a second. But I really want to know, how does someone feel in that situation?
Well, how do you think we feel? We feel like crap. But I mean, look, the truth is, there's a lot of variables on how a CEO feels at the moment. So, you know, we didn't know that, I don't look at the stock as much as others do, obviously. I look at the business, and the business had done extraordinarily well over the periods of COVID, some because of COVID, our international growth, and some because of work that we had done that had sort of been in conjunction at the timing of COVID. But when you know your business suddenly stops and you don't have an answer for why it stopped or where the bottom is, there's a lot of variables. You have a lot of constituents to communicate with. But the first thing is, you know, about a week and a half or so before your earnings call, and in about 2 weeks, we had a sense that we didn't know. We didn't know where the bottom was. That's probably the most difficult part because you can't tell anybody. So, you know, I stayed in our home by myself so that I wouldn't share it, and that nobody could see my mood, and to wrestle with my team over how we would communicate it. Then you have to get down to the business of doing your job, right? It's not good news, but it is your responsibility to communicate bad news. So you have Wall Street, you have the analysts, you have the press, you have your employees, you have your business partners, you have your board, you have your management team. The students don't care. That's not what they look at. They just want to make sure that Chegg exists. So, you know, we had to have honest and transparent communication messages for each of those constituents. And then you're stuck with a specific date. Ours was November 1st. The truth is, we didn't know where the bottom was on November 1st. And whereas most companies didn't give guidance during COVID, we did, because the business had grown so far that we couldn't keep up with the growth. And that was the good part of it. So as a business, I had to look at it and say, as a business, despite what happened, which is lack of visibility into the third and fourth quarter of last year, and despite the fact that more students didn't go back to school, not because of anything Chegg did. So the next thing you ask yourself before you report is it bad execution or is it the market overall? Well, I called every CEO in the market and spoke to every CEO in the market. So I was very cognizant of the fact that we were not alone. We were just one of the few public companies. The rest of them were private. So I knew this was an industry-wide situation. We had surveyed many of our students very quickly to find out what was going on. We looked at the employment numbers. It turns out that when unemployment is low, college enrollment goes down. When unemployment is high, college enrollment goes up. Well, when people were being paid a fortune to go back to work, and the majority of American students work, you know, 30 hours a week or more, 70% go to public schools, not private schools that everybody hears about. Many of them have jobs, as I pointed out, 26% of them have children. So it was no surprise that many fewer went back and were taking fewer courses and easier courses because COVID had done a lot of things to people. But that just showed up overnight. So going on television and talking about it is my job, it's my responsibility. And, you know, Jim Cramer of CNBC and David Faber and Sarah Eisen, you know, Carl Cantinier, they're all professionals. And what they've always said is, you got to come on in the good times and the bad times, just tell your story. So I felt it was important to represent our employees to the public markets. Like, we're here, we're showing up, we're not afraid. The business was actually good, just not nearly as good. We actually beat Q3 numbers, just not as good as we had anticipated.
As the expectations.
Right. And then as you saw from the next quarters, we blew out the next quarter number because we didn't know where the bottom was when we reported. And thank goodness it wasn't as bad as we thought. And the businesses started to rebound faster. Then
exactly.
We get caught up, you know, so you feel nervous, you feel, you know, depressed, you feel unhappy. Then you got to suck it up and do your job. You know, every one of my employees has to do their job during COVID, has to do their job whether the stock goes up and down. I have to do mine, or I wouldn't be showing the respect to my employees that they keep showing our students, each other, and myself. So nobody likes it. It's not the first time I've had to have a bad interview on television about something that changed in the business, but we've had so many more good ones than bad ones. The odds are in our favor.
Yeah, and I would say it wasn't a bad interview. It was a great
truthful
interview on a bad, you know, on a bad situation. So the interview itself, you were very candid, you were open, you said, look, I don't have the visibility. It's not that I'm saying that that's it, it's done. It's just, but on the flip side, like you mentioned, 3 months later, you came out with amazing results. And I'm sharing the annual slide deck that you guys have on the investor relations site, where your revenue grew, you had better visibility, people were going back to the education space, and you started giving better guidance and kind of saying, look, I can give you guidance, but only, if I remember correctly, 9 to 12 months forward and not beyond that. Again, because I want to be prudent with the messages and not try to be too optimistic on the future. So let's talk about what you see now going forward at the company. Why should an investor, and we have thousands of investors that are going to see this video, why should they believe that the situation has changed? And they don't need to believe, they have the results, but they still need to be confident in the company going forward, not having the same lack of visibility or lowering the expectations like it happened in the past.
Yeah, look, when you're a trader, there's nothing much I can say to you, but when you're a long-term investor, you ask yourself, can you bet on the big trends? And what are the big trends? So do you think more people are going to have to learn online? More people are going to need support. More people are going to have to pay for it themselves. And more people are coming from diverse backgrounds and don't have the support in their home or the money in their home to give them that academic support. We all know, and the Middle East is a great example of it, where 50% of the world's population is below the age of 30. So it's not that we benefit from online learning. We provide our learning and our support online. We benefit when a student learns anywhere. So if you think more people are going to have to learn more business and more STEM, and they're going to need more support, and they're from more diverse backgrounds, and you think they're going to look online for affordable and super high quality, then that's a trend that we believe is inevitable. And that would cause you to say that we want to look at companies like Chegg, and hopefully Chegg in particular. In terms of visibility, we obviously can't speak to that because that it's against the law. Yeah. And so we would never do that. But the history of Chegg as a public company has been one that prior to Q3 and 4 of last year, we had 18 straight quarters of beat and raise. And so historically, we have had the confidence because we've had a subscription business. You saw from that interview with Sarah Eisen that if we don't have the confidence, we don't share it. Now, we can be wrong. Anybody can be wrong. But from our standpoint, we just believe in the inevitable. We think the market we're in is massive. We think the position that we have is being the largest player in the space, more students than anybody that are paying us. I think we're the only profitable company. We produce free cash flow. We have $2 billion in cash on the balance sheet. So we're in a position to maximize the opportunity in this market, and nobody else really is. So we feel comfortable that we have all the right tools to achieve the mission that we have, which is to support tens of millions and hundreds of millions of students around the world.
So let's talk about expansion very quickly, because I know you might have a hard stop. So you're expanding outside the U.S. You've talked about Middle East, and you've talked about Europe and others.
The audience expanded for us. So initially, we were only in English. During COVID, what happened was when students around the world, in Israel and every other country, needed to not go to school and get all the subsidies in terms of the help that they got at school, they went on the internet and they discovered Chegg. As they've gone back, they still love Chegg. And so outside the U.S., we went from nearly zero to over 1.5 million subscribers in 3 years. And so that's why a lot of analysts are bullish on our international business, as are we, because we've seen that growth. And now we're investing in more experts. We're investing in translation. We're investing in asking Q&A in any local languages and pricing locally. So we're making significant investments to make ourselves more available and more affordable for students around the world. So international can be and should be a very big part of our future.
And that's really at the beginning. It's not at the infancy,
it's at the beginning.
But it's at the beginning, I want to say.
It's super early on.
Yeah.
Because, look, the U.S., there's 8 billion people in the world. The U.S. is only 320 million of them.
Exactly.
So there's no reason to believe that outside the U.S. couldn't be larger than our U.S. business over time. And we've said that. Andy, our CFO, said that on another earnings call. So we're investing heavily to provide support locally to any student who's putting their hands up entering the learning process and saying, I want, I need help. And they come to Chegg and we're grateful for that.
Amazing. Last question. Anything you want to share with our viewers? Anything you want to share with whether... So my viewers are not only in Israel. Some are in the US, some are in the UK, some are... But they speak Hebrew. This video is going to be posted in English as well. So you now have the opportunity to share with the global, whether it's employee, potential employees, investors, anyone, something that you feel I missed, which is fine, because it's a short discussion.
I don't know that you've missed anything about Chegg. I'm grateful for the opportunity to share just how big the opportunity is to support students trying to improve their life through education. And we help them improve their outcomes by providing learning support and job skills through our skills business and math help and writing help. And so we are betting on the inevitable. And I think people that invest with us are betting on the inevitable and well as well. And hopefully our management team, who's been together now for, you know, over a decade, because we really love and believe in this mission. And the only thing I would say to your viewers beyond that is, if you're smart enough to try to learn about investing, then you know how important it is to invest responsibly. If you're younger, the speculative stuff, if you're going to do it, take minor risks on it. But compounded interest is always the way to go, right?
You never and go invest in good companies.
Money. Yeah, look, invest in good companies for the long term. You never go broke by making money. You don't have to hit, you don't have to get rich overnight. You accumulate wealth over time by making good decisions, spending your money wisely, investing in good companies and in things that you believe in and you love and you trust and you want to see succeed. So with that, I'm just grateful for the opportunity to meet you. I want to thank our office in Israel for encouraging me in the loudest possible way to join your show. And I hope everybody, stays vigilant, stays healthy and stays happy. And, obviously, all of our hearts are with the Ukraine right now. I happen to be of Ukrainian descent. My grandfather came from Russian-Ukrainian border, depending on the year. It's hard to know where he was from, but it was near Chernobyl. And so, our hearts go out to all the people there that are standing up for their freedom and anything we can do to support them, we're going to try to do. So anyway, thank you so much for the opportunity and hopefully we'll talk again.
Thank you very much. And yeah, fully support Ukraine for all their effort. Dan Rosenzweig, the CEO and chairman of Chegg. Thank you very, very much. Or in Hebrew, as we say, toda raba. Thank you. And to all my viewers, I hope you enjoyed this conversation. Thank you.
Shalom.
Dan, thank you very much.
All right. Yeah.